Well, hello beautiful YouTubers. Welcome back to my channel, Sun and Shade. So today we have a lot of sun. We're going to continue going through the list of the bird advisors. It's a free list. It's a free identification chart that you can also print out. They have pictures of the birds for you. And so today we'll cover about 8 more birds. And if we go through quickly, we may finish the list, but there's about 31 birds on this list. So we may not finish today, and we may have one more part. So the first bird, and I think by far this is the most adorable looking little bird. It's called the Eastern Phoebe, and you can see it has brown on it. Top of its crown there. Let's see, they'll give us their ID. So let's get started here. Okay, so the Eastern Phoebe spend breeding season in Vermont and occur in 27% of the checklist. They mainly are spotted in mid-March to October. So that is, we're in March, and they're going to be spotted all the way to October, so we definitely want to keep our eyes out. I have seen that bird, but I don't see the bird as a common sight. So let's see where it resides. Well, first of all, they give us a description. So the Eastern Phoebes are plump songbirds that are grayish brown on the back with whitish underneath with a darker head. And their length is 5.5 to 6.7 inches, so they're a little bit bigger than the sparrow. Their weight is 0.6 to 0.7 ounces, and their wingspan is 10.2 to approximately 11 inches. The Eastern Phoebes are migratory, so they breed across the northeastern to central United States and into Canada before migrating to southeastern United States and Mexico for the winter. So they go all the way to Mexico. They vacay in Mexico for the winter. Some birds may remain all year towards the south part of their range. Eastern Phoebes tend to be found along quiet woodlands, wagging their tails from low perches rather than pairs or flocks. So, okay. So you'll find them in the lower parts. Oh, that's interesting. I'm going to have to really look for them this spring. As they are flycatchers, flying insects make up most of their diet, but they will also eat spiders and other insects, small fruit and seeds. So if you get fruity bird seed, that will enhance the possibility of them coming to your yard. They often nest on bridges and barns or houses and make a nest of mud and grass. Okay, so around the barn areas, maybe if they're looking for mud and grass, maybe around ponds too, I might add. So to attract them to your backyard, put up a nest box and native plants that produce berries. Okay. That's awesome to know, because that's a beautiful bird. Let's see what they sound like. Oh, I've heard that. I have absolutely heard that. Isn't that, that's such a beautiful song. Whoops, sorry about that. So that is really beautiful. Whoops. So I'm going to be looking for the Eastern Phoebe for sure. This is the tufted titmouse. And look how adorable that is. It looks like the waxwing, cedar waxwing, a little bit like it. Let's see here. So tufted titmouse do not migrate, and they're spotted in Vermont all year long. They look like a miniature blue jay also. They appear in 20% of the summer checklist and 28% of the winter checklist. So that's not much. I know I, again, I have not seen them. I've seen them, but not readily. Tufted titmouses are gray on the back and white underneath, with a cute gray crest and large eyes. They're often a flock with chickadees. Good to know. Nuthatches and woodpeckers. The nuthatches and the woodpeckers, again, I haven't seen really up here in northern Vermont. Chickadees, yes. Their length is 5.5 to 6.3 inches. Their weight 0.6 to 0.9, so they're really little. Looking at that picture, I'd think that they were a little bigger. Let's look at that. They've got big eyes, so they're really little. Okay, and they've got that pointy kind of blue jay type of hairstyle going, or feather style going on. Wingspan 7.9 to 10.2 inches. The tufted titmouse live in eastern and southeastern United States, as it says, all year, so they don't leave. You can find them in the woodlands, parks, backyard feeders, and they can be assertive over smaller birds, pushing in to get to the food first. Something like the blue jay again, right? They're definitely aggressive. A tufted titmouse eat insects in the summer, including caterpillars, beetles, ants, and wasps. That's a plus. I know I want to attract them because wasps will go right after you, no problem. They don't go the other way necessarily, as well as spiders and snails. And they also eat seeds, nuts, berries, and will hoard shelled seeds. Interesting. Something like the little squirrel. To attract them to your backyard, use sunflower seeds, soot, and peanuts on the feeders or soot cages. Soot cages, they are very, depending where you get them, like $1.97, $2. They don't cost much at all, and they last depending how many birds you have coming in, but they'll last a couple of weeks easy. Maybe a week if you have lots and lots of birds, but I think longer. I've tried them a few times. I do the loose seed though, but they will also eat from platform feeders. You can also try putting up a nest box to attract them. I'm definitely going to find places to put nest boxes. I'll bring you along with me on that project. But that's one of the things I want to do this spring. Let's see what the tufted titmouse sounds like. Isn't that beautiful? I can't say I hear that sound a lot around here, but I'm going to listen for it. Okay, so that's the tufted titmouse. And let's see what's next. Dark-eyed junco. Now, this one for sure. This one I have out here. Dark-eyed junco. Look how adorable this bird is. It's precious. It's like one of my favorite. Oh, they're all my favorite. I can't even pick one. But dark-eyed juncos are frequently spotted in Vermont during winter. They stay here from October to April. Oh, so these guys are going to be leaving, because I've had them here pretty much all winter. But some also remain in the state all year. So it might depend on their food source. I wonder. They are recorded in 8% of the summer checklist and 33% of the winter checklist. Their length is 5.5 to 6.3 inches. Now, I have to tell you, having seen them, I would describe them as a plump little bird, bigger for sure than the sparrow. They're just adorable, just even slightly bigger than a chickadee, I'd say. But this sounds like they're a little bigger than the chickadee because they go to 6.3 inches. Their weight is 0.6 to 1.5 ounces, and their wingspan is 7 to 9.8 inches. So the dark-eyed juncos remain resident all year in northeastern western United States in the Appalachian Mountains. These that breed in Canada and Alaska migrate south in the winter to the United States. They can be found in open and partially wooded areas on the ground and are common across the continent. Oh, so they're common. I tell you, before this winter, I have not noticed them, so I don't know what the difference is, because I would have noticed them. To attract them to the feeder, use black oil sunflower seeds, Niger, cracked corn, millet, peanuts, and platform feeders are scattered on the ground is best. Let's see what they sound like. Yeah. I mean, that's beautiful. That's so distinct that if you hear that, you'll know it. Yeah. Yeah, I've definitely heard that. That's just beautiful. Now we are at our hairy woodpecker with a little red on his head there. And let's see what I'm curious on the sightings. Hairy woodpeckers are spotted all over Vermont. They appear in 16% of the summer checklist and 25% of the winter. Okay. Hairy woodpeckers are medium-sized woodpeckers with black and white pattern and large white patch on their backs. The males have a flash of red. Of course they do. Towards the back of their heads. Because they're the pretty ones. They are visually similar to downy woodpeckers, but larger with a longer bill. And they are often found in the same areas. It is hard to tell them apart if they are not near each other. Their length is 7.1 to 10.2 inches, a good size bird. That picture made them look a little smaller than that. Their weight is 1.4 to 3.4 ounces, and their wingspan is 13.16.1 ounce. Hairy woodpeckers do not migrate, and they live in the United States and Canada all year, except far north Canada. So I've seen them on and off in my life, but I haven't seen them up here in the north. And there's not a heck of a lot of trees around here for them to be eating their insects. There's more ponds, and that's due to construction. You can find hairy woodpeckers in the woodlands, on trunks, main branches of the tree, large trees, but they're also found in a wide variety of habitats, including woodlots, parks, cemeteries. That's interesting. Maybe because there's old trees in cemeteries. Hairy woodpeckers' diets is mostly insects. Yeah. So let's see what that, sounds like, along maybe with the pecking. There we go. Sounds like a mouse. Sounds like a cricket almost. The hairy woodpecker. Interesting. It's a quiet sound. Okay, so next we have the chipping sparrow. I have seen these because I've noted the stripes and the face. I've seen these. Look how adorable that little sparrow is. So, you know, you have some sparrows. I think the song sparrow, right, is the entire body is beige with stripes. Chipping sparrows are frequently spotted in Vermont during the summer. They breed from April to November and are recorded in 24% of the summer checklist. So they're heading in. They'll be heading in this month. Chipping sparrows are slender, long-tailed birds with grayish belly, brown and black streaked back, with a rusty crown and black-eyed line. In the winter, the colors are subdued. Their length is 4.7 to 5.9 inches, their weight is 0.4 to 0.6 ounces, and their wingspan is approximately 8.3 inches. These chipping sparrows spend their summer breeding in US and Canada before flying to Mexico and Florida, so that's where they vacay for the winter. Some remain all year in the southern United States, so it might depend if we're having a harsh winter. And of course, here in Vermont, we've had a mild winter. As far as Vermont winters go, you can find chipping sparrows in small flocks on the ground and will come to backyards for many kinds of bird seed. So they're not super picky. That's good. So we'll go back up and listen to the song. But to attract them, seeds, cracked corn, your open feeders, brown birds are often overlooked, but once you get to know a few of them, oh yeah, I mean, there's totally a difference. You'll know when you see this chipping sparrow from the regular song sparrow. So let's see what this one sounds like. Isn't that adorable? Yeah, let's see here. Okay, so next we have the American tree sparrow. This is tiny, I think. I think this one's tiny, the American tree sparrow. So these are the sparrow family, of the sparrow family, and they're spotted from October until May. And they're recorded in 16% of the summer checklists. They are tiny, though. American tree sparrows are long-tailed, brown-streaked, plump birds with rusty caps, gray faces, and a rusty eyeline. Their length is about 5.5 inches, so that's tiny. 0.5 to 1 ounce, and their wingspan 9.4. American tree sparrows are a bird of winter in US and a bird of summer in Canada. Interesting. They breed in the far north of Canada and in Alaska and migrate to the US for winter, except for the Pacific and Gulf Coast. You may find American tree sparrows foraging on in small flocks in weedy fields and under bird feeders. So this is part of the reason why the bird population here has gone way down, is because the fields that we had, they're gone. There's building after building after building in those fields. Now they tried to do a compromise, and they even had an article on this, compromising where when they build a building, they will put in vegetation. However, it is totally not the same. We know this. It's not a natural habitat. It's contained and it's cut back, and there's people walking around and through it. Because what it is like, flower pots and this and that. It does help the insects for sure, and maybe some birds, but the bird population, they need to be able to have some space more than that. So American tree sparrow sounds, the males sing a song is pleasant from late winter before migration. Their song is tuneful. Oops, I think we skipped here. No, I guess that's it. So let's listen to their song. That's that pretty. I've totally heard that, yeah. So you'll hear that super, super high-pitched sound because that is very high-pitched. The frequency is so high, you almost don't hear it at the beginning. The nests of the American tree sparrows are usually on or near the ground and are made of twigs, grass, and moss. Good to know. So if you have a mossy area, you'll know to look for these birds when you hear that sound. So anyway, they lay around 5 eggs, and these just take under 2 weeks to hatch and just over a week for the young to fledge. Wow, that is fast. That is super fast. So this is interesting, though. I just want to reiterate that they are usually on or near the ground, and they're made of twigs, grass, and moss. That's why they like the fields. They like to hide in the fields. So see, contained vegetation would not do it for them to make a nest. No way. Red-breasted nuthatch. So we covered the nuthatch earlier, and this is the red-breasted nuthatch. Isn't that beautiful? That's just gorgeous. The red-breasted nuthatches can be spotted in Vermont all year. They're recorded in 12% of the checklist and 14% of the winter list. Red-breasted nuthatches are blue-gray birds with black and white stripes on their heads and rusty underside. So they're about, they're only 4.3 inches. Okay, so they're tiny. Their weight is 0.3 to 0.5. Their wingspan, 7.1 to 7.9. inches. Their red-breasted nuthatches remain all year in northeastern and western states, Alaska, and Canada, but they do move south in the winter if cone crops are poor. So see, yeah, if the food, that's what's happening. I mean, they do move. It's just like pigeons. They have four hubs that they will establish to move around to during the day. They have to make sure they have food, right? You can find red-breasted nuthatches in coniferous woods, forage cones, and they also visit backyard feeders. When they say cones, I believe they're talking about pine cones. To attract the red-breasted nuthatches in your backyard, put sunflower seeds out, soot feeders, peanuts, and mealworms. And as I said in my other video, I've put mealworms and I didn't get anything, but who knows, maybe I'll try it again. This is what they sound like. Isn't that interesting? So let's listen to that again. They kind of sound like a cat. Or I mean, that is super distinctive. So yeah, if you hear that, you'll know it's a nuthatch. Okay, now the European starlings, this is very close to my heart because 8 years ago when I moved up here in this area, I kid you not, there were thousands of these baby starlings, just thousands. Ever since they put up this last building, I don't see them. I'm telling you, it is the saddest. It really is. I really miss the starlings. We had so many of them here. European starlings are introduced species in Vermont that can be seen in the state all year. They appear up to 17% of the summer and winter checklist. They are not native, but they are now one of the most numerous songbirds. They are stocky black birds with iridescent purple, green, and blue tones, and just gorgeous. Their length, 7.9 to 9.1 inches. Their weight, 2.1 to 3.4 ounces. And their wingspan is a foot to 15.8 inches. European starlings live in North America, except northern Canada or Alaska. They are considered a pest by some due to their aggressive behavior, but these birds fly in large, noisy flocks, and I mean large. And now it's down to nothing. It's just heartbreaking. And they can be seen perched in groups on top of trees and flying over fields. They would also perch on the the lines out here, the electrical lines that were above the marsh in the weedy tiny little field we have. The fields that we had, like I said, are now obsolete as of this last building, gone. Starlings predominantly eat insects, including beetles, flies, caterpillars, earthworms, which we have a ton of around here, and spiders. However, they also eat fruit, including cherries, holly berries, mulberries, Virginia creeper, sumac, blackberries, grains, and seeds. To attract them, try sunflower seeds, soot and cracked corns, and peanuts. So let's see, it's a beautiful sound. I mean, in groups, it's just calming as can be when you hear this sound. So that's the starling. Now, the eastern kingbird. I saw one of these up the street several years ago. I was driving in the car. Eastern kingbird. Okay, there it is. Beautiful little bird. Eastern kingbirds are spotted in Vermont from April to September. So they're not here that long. And they're in 17% of the summer checklist. These birds are medium-sized, large-headed flycatchers, and they are blackish on the back and white underneath. Their heads are darker black, and they have a white tip on the tail. I saw one of these. It was down near the river. Let's say I'm curious to find out where they reside. They get their name king from the aggression they show each other and other birds when they defend their nests. So they have concealed crown of yellow, orange, and red feathers, which they raise when defending themselves, for their nest. Their length is 7.5 to 9.1 inches. Their weight is 1.2 to 1.9 ounces. Their wingspan is 13 to 15 inches. They breed in the United States before heading south to Central and South America for the winter. They usually breed in fields, orchards, and along forest edges. Okay, yeah, where I saw it was a little forest along the river, like over the bridge. They can often be found nested, there it is, near water. Okay, such as rivers and lakes. Well, that explains that one. I haven't seen one since. Eastern kingbirds catch insects in the midair, including bees, wasps, ants, beetles, crickets, grasshoppers, bugs, flies. They will often perch up upon fields, waiting for the insect to fly. They will also eat fruit, including service berries, cherries, blackberries, and elderberries. What a wonderful diet. Lots of protein. There's a lot of protein there. Okay, so to attract them to your backyard, put in some native berry bushes. If you don't have a backyard and you're in an apartment, you can buy berry bushes. They'll come around and have lots, put them on your deck or whatever. They'll figure out you're there. And having lots of native veggies for them to, that attracts insects. And the next is the white-throated sparrow. And then we're going to do one more and then we'll call it good for today. So the white-throated sparrow. Oops, we didn't do the sound. Whoops, that's important. We got to do the sound of our, are they giving us a sound here? Oh, they don't give us a song for the Eastern Kingbird. Okay, that's all right. I mean, I don't see it there. It went up and down a couple times. And okay, so now we're on to the white-throated sparrow. So this is an adorable little bird, looks like a little snowball. The white-throated sparrows can be spotted in Vermont all year, but they're most common during the spring and the fall, from May to October. They are recorded to about 42% of the checklist, which I totally believe because I've seen these. White-throated sparrows have a distinctive black and white striped head, brown-white throat, yellow between the eye and bill, and their beaks are brown and underneath is gray. They're about 6.3 to 7.1 inches. I'm surprised they're that long. 0.8 to 1.1 ounce, wingspan 7.9 to 9.1 inches. The white-throated sparrows are migratory and they breed mainly in Canada before they head south in the winter to the eastern and southern United States and the Pacific coast. So you can find the white-throated sparrows on the ground, in forest, woods, along the edges of wooded areas, often in large flocks. None of my birds I have out here are in large flocks. I will tell you, even the pigeons, no large flocks here. The pigeons might have the most at this point, where the starlings used to be the ones. White-throated sparrows diet in mainly seeds of grasses, weeds, fruits such as grapes, sumac, mountain ash, blueberry, blackberry, and dogwood. They will also eat many insects from the forest floor, especially in the summer. To attract them, put out millet or black sunflower seeds, so those may work. Now, let's see what these sound like. Yeah. Such a familiar and just celestial sound is just so beautiful. You can remember some of these sounds of birds from when you were a child. I can. This one in particular. You'll know when you hear that beautiful whistle, that beautiful sound is the white-throated sparrow. White-throated sparrow. Now, so we're going to end on the red-bellied woodpecker. And so this has a lot of red on its head, lots of speckles. And let's see, I've seen a woodpecker, but with a crest. So, let's see what it says about this one. Woodpeckers are residents of Vermont all year long. They're recorded in 9% of the summer and winter checklists. Red-bellied woodpeckers can be mistaken for red-headed woodpeckers. Now, and as they have caps, but they are much smaller than the red-headed woodpecker. Female red-bellied woodpeckers lack the red cap and only have red on the back of their heads. Okay, so the female only has it like on the back of their necks is what I think they're trying to say, or the back of their heads are saying, but the male has on his head. So, they also have a very pale red belly that can be hard to spot. So they do not have the typical woodpecker black and white markings over their backs. So you just see it on their wings. But red-bellied woodpeckers can be found in the eastern United States and they do not migrate. I don't think they're giving us a song again here. Let's see. Maybe down. Oh, there it is. So their length is about 9.4 inches. Their weight is 2 to 3.2 ounces and their wingspan is 13 inches to 16 and a half inches. So they have a really good wingspan. Red-bellied woodpeckers eat insects, spiders, seeds from grasses, fruits, nuts. They will also sometimes eat nestlings. They nest in dead trees and so to get the insects, and they may use the same nest year after year. So they lay 4 to 5 white eggs on the bed of the wood chips. The tongue of the red-bellied woodpecker sticks out about 2 inches past the beak and is barbed at the tip, along with a sticky spit, of course, and that helps them catch their prey in deep crevices. Makes perfect sense. Red-bellied woodpeckers can be seen at bird feeders, especially if you live near wooded areas, and they make a distinctive loud rolling call, which means you will often hear them before you see them. So let's take a listen. Okay, so that is the red-bellied woodpecker. And so we're going to end there. We'll end up with the next video. We'll end with our red-bellied woodpecker. And the next video, you know, I have so much information. I got a free chart on vegetation. And it's beautiful, and I'm going to, I printed it out so I can read it to you as I show it to you on the internet. It's, I can pull it up and show it to you like I'm showing you the birds. So, and I'll probably take my frame out so the whole frame will be the vegetation so you can really take a good look at it. But it's a beautiful chart. And I will direct you to that. I'll give you a content when we do that video. I'd like that to be the video after the next one, after we finish the birds. So anyway, I appreciate you being with me today on my journey going through the Vermont birds. And, you know, they need our help right now. And I appreciate you. Jump on board and subscribe. It's totally free. I'd love to hear your comments and suggestions, especially if you know your birds. If you don't know your birds, because I'm kind of halfway in between. I know some birds, and I'm still learning. So anyway, thank you, and we'll see you in the next one.